We have a real treat here for our keynote kickoff in Erik Qualman. He came to us from Florida last night. He is the author of two amazing books. This is a person who knows about the internet and the way it can impact lots of people. And these two books, Socialnomics, How Social Media Transforms the Way We Live and Do Business, is a must read if you haven't already read it. And his latest book, Digital Leader, has, and it says here, propelled him to be voted the second most likable author in the world behind Harry Potter's J.K. Rowling. And I got a chance to get to know him a little bit earlier, and I knew right away that that's the case, because he is truly an expert in his field, and he's going to share his wisdom with us. So join me in welcoming Mr. Erik Qualman.
Morning, thank you. I think my mom even voted for J.K. Rowling, so that's okay. But as Amy mentioned, well, first of all, thanks for letting me be here this morning. Thanks to Eli Lilly for bringing me in. What a great place to be with the election coming up. But also yesterday, Newsweek announced after 80 years that they're no longer going to do a print version. So it's incredible to be here at the Newseum the day after that was announced. And just remember when people used to say, turn off your electronics, turn off your phone while the speaker. Well, obviously, that's not the case anymore. Please turn it on. And just as a quick reminder, here is the hashtag. So you have no excuse for not remembering what the hashtag is. The thing I like so much about this hashtag is that it's short. One, it's short, so it made it easy to make the t-shirt. But also, two, is it's smart. So now I know these guys know what they're doing. Because a lot of places I go, it might be this long, which isn't good for the t-shirt. But it's also not good for Twitter, because you have a limit of 140 characters. So all of a sudden, you're just chewing up the amount that you can actually tweet. So not only is it easy to remember, but it also doesn't chew up as many characters. And this is what we're going to talk about today. It's those little things that we forget. Like, you think they're common sense, but common sense isn't all that common when it comes to digital media. Change is inevitable in the digital space. Just taking a quick time machine back on how I got involved in this space, because the story is relevant, is that I was an intern at Cadillac, the automotive company, and one of my jobs as an intern was to print out the memo, to print out what was said in the meeting. And if some of you guys remember, you had to highlight in yellow everyone's name, put it on the chairs, or if they're in another office, send in this thing called interoffice mail with the little red string. So that was part of my glorious internship. And one day I go, well, this takes a lot of my time. Why don't I use this new thing called email? And so I go, what, can I attach this? So I attach it, figure it out, send it out. All of a sudden, 3 minutes later, the CEO of the company, I've never met the CEO before, he's standing right next to me in my cube, and I go, oh, this is my moment to shine. He's going to be so happy that I did this. He was the furthest thing from happy. I had 5 minutes to explain why I should keep my internship. And so I explained, well, this saves an hour of my time. I could tell by the look on his face that was the least of his concerns, how I spent my time. And I said, well, this saves the environment. We don't have to print out the paper. Now, remember, this was the 90s. No one really cared about the environment. But the third thing that I said was, hey, we can track this. No one could say they didn't get it. So then he goes, okay. So he goes away. A couple months later, all of a sudden, this thing called the World Wide Web explodes. So everyone needs these things called websites. And so the VP is explaining to the CEO, we need a website. After about 2 minutes, the CEO goes, I have no idea what you're talking about, but you've already wasted 2 minutes of my time. Perhaps you can go. And now remember, when you hand out email addresses, a lot of times it's first initial, last name. And so my email address is equalman. And he goes, why don't you go talk to that kid that thinks he's a superhero on the first floor? Maybe he can help with this thing called the website. So I bring that story up because it's comical and laughable now that I was almost fired for sending an attachment and email. But this stuff repeats itself again and again. If we look just back at the search, when search first exploded, 75% of companies blocked search, blocked Google to their employees during the workday. That seems laughable now. How could you get your job done without having access to Google? Now, 54% of companies block social media to their employees. So it's the same thing. We'll kind of look back and laugh at it. But obviously, everyone in this room understands this is the time, this is the opportunity, and that window can be sometimes short when things change quickly, whether it's Pinterest or Instagram, which was mentioned this morning. But if you take advantage of that shift, you can really get ahead in this world, and that's the beautiful thing. So I'm hoping that today is just the start of a conversation. As mentioned, you can reach out to me at Equalman across the board, whether it's on Twitter, whether it's on Yahoo, whether it's on Google, wherever you want to reach me, just send me a note. If you have a question, we'll try to get an answer to you as quickly as possible. It's key in that video to understand that it's not about technology, it's really about relationship building, and you on the nonprofit side, you know that. And so it's to not get confused when we think about this, isn't it necessarily a technology play, it's really again an extension of those relationships that we build offline, but it's taking it and putting it online. And so what we'll see throughout this is I might use examples from government, I might use examples from nonprofit, I'll use a lot of examples from business sector. And remember that no matter what it is, the majority of the stuff, 95% of it, the constructs are the same. And so when you look at that, get inspiration and figure out, okay, they did this, how do I use that in my organization today? Because all of us are different out there in what you're trying to get done. So just look at these examples and try to apply it to your filter and how you can use it to gain the success that you want to have. So what is Socialnomics, that term? What does that mean? At a 10-second level, all it is it's word of mouth on digital steroids. It is that simple, that we care more about what our friends and peers think about things than what any other source tells us to think. And so that's nothing new. It's just word of mouth, and now it's at a whole new level. Or if you think about it, word of mouth is now world of mouth. If we've got Canada and also the UK watching here today, that's the shift that we've seen. So now, how far away are we from seeing this in today's world? Well, first of all, how many of you guys have kids? Okay, majority of the room have children. I've got two little girls, and so I'm introduced to Babies R Us. And so that's in the offline world. I walk in, this thing's mammoth and overwhelming. I go to the first aisle to get a pacifier, thinking that there's gonna be a pink one for a girl and a blue one for a boy. There's over 100 different types of pacifiers. There's some that if you drop them on the floor, they close up so no germs get on them. There's also some that glow in the dark, which now I know why they sell those. And so we're only in the fourth aisle, and we've already been in the store for an hour and a half. And now we're in an aisle to buy the stroller, which I come to find out you need to have basically three different strollers. But we're in the stroller aisle, and trying to figure out what this is. There's 70 different strollers. There's three wheels, four wheels, five cup holders, no cup holders. So I don't really know what to do. So the way that looks today is I'll go home and do some more research online. But in the Socialnomic world, the way it will look is essentially you'll just pull out your smartphone and go up and scan a code. Let's say for argument's sake that it's a QR code, which you guys have seen those. Those are the black and white ugly things that you see people use to get on the airplane. That stands for quick response code. So I go up there and just scan that stroller, and it'll come back to me and it'll say, of your 237 friends on Facebook, the average person has 237 friends on Facebook. If you have more than that, congratulations, you're very popular. But of your 237 friends on Facebook, did you know that 20 have purchased a stroller in the last year? And of those 20, 10 have purchased that stroller you just scanned. And all of them give it 4 or 5 star rating. So all of a sudden, boom, I'm done. I don't have to do any more research. Stress-free, I get that stroller. And that can be applied across the board no matter what you're trying to do. In the nonprofit world, what does that look like? It's already existed forever when people buy, let's say, a brick so that their name is on that brick. And people can see, oh, this person donated to this organization. Well, it's a lot different when it's digital. If you can put that out there digitally and they can see it real time, it's a lot easier way to increase that viral activity out there. So the same concept, you're just applying it digitally. A lot of this stuff isn't new. It's just putting that digital twist on it. So how far away are we from this kind of babies R Us example? Well, in the for-profit world, we already see it out there. If you look at TripAdvisor, which a lot of us in this room use for hotels recommendations, is that if you can see this screenshot, what it's going to tell you is that it's still going to show you those ratings and reviews that have always existed, but now it's going to pull in via Facebook that, hey, did you know that 40 of your friends have actually been to Cabo San Lucas? Or that these friends are currently there at Cabo San Lucas? And so the huge shift is now I still have those 104 ratings from people that I don't know, but now I have those 40 ratings from people that I do know. And so I could say, wow, this person's taste is terrible. I'm not going to look at that. This other person's taste is fantastic when it comes to restaurants and hotels. So if they say it's 4-star or 5-star, it's a no-brainer. I'm going to stay there. So that's going to be applied across the board. So in time, every product and service will be rated. Every organization will be rated. And every person is going to be rated. So how is a person rated? Well, they're rated on tools like LinkedIn. So just 2 weeks ago, LinkedIn's always had the ability for you to get a review from a peer or from a boss or from a subordinate. But now they've made it even easier on LinkedIn to where that you can just hit a button that says endorse. So it's like a like on Facebook, but it's for an individual. Just a thumbs up, this person is endorsed around this subject. It could be around politics, it could be around movies, whatever it is, they're getting endorsements on LinkedIn. Now, if you're not currently on LinkedIn, if you take nothing away from here today, you should get on LinkedIn because if you're on LinkedIn and have your profile at 100% completion, and LinkedIn will tell you if you're at 100% completion, meaning that you've got your photo up there, you've got where you went to college, you've got which organization you're from. Is if you're at 100% profile, it takes 5 minutes to get 100% profile. You get 40 times more, not only job opportunities, most of us have a job, but 40 times more opportunities, whether it be nonprofit, whether it be business. 40 times more opportunities if you're on LinkedIn and have that 100% profile completion. Because people want to deal with people they know, and so they can tell quickly what you stand for on LinkedIn. Clout's another tool. That's just taking all your digital activity and giving you a score of 0 to 100. It used to be that Justin Bieber had the highest score until a couple months ago. They said, this can't be right. Let's readjust our formula. So now Barack Obama has the highest score at a 99. But it's looking at what is your activity and influence around certain sectors so that companies or nonprofits can find those people easily. So a quick example of that is that if you wanted to launch a new movie in New York, is that you could send to people with a score of 80 to 100 on movies, hey, you're invited to the premiere and Matt Damon will be there. You just show up for free and then make sure that you tweet or Facebook about this movie that's out there. So that's what we talk about when everybody will be rated in time. So now what are the things that we can do to have success in the nonprofit world when it comes to social media? It's really about listen what's being said or written or posted about my organization. It's then to interact, to actually join that conversation. The third is then to react. And this is where most organizations drop the ball. Is that if 80% say they love what you're doing here, are you doing more of that today? Are you having that meeting at 12 at midnight to say 80% have said they like this about our organization? Are we doing more today? Conversely, if 90% say they don't like that you're doing this, are you changing how you do the things you do starting today? And the last piece is really to sell. Whether you're trying to sell or get people to buy into your organization, whether you're trying to get them to donate, is it's in human nature for us to start there first. Hey, we need money, or hey, you need to join our organization, you need to join our movement. The reason that doesn't work digitally is because it doesn't work offline. If you think about it, if we're out there at breakfast, if you went up to four people that you don't know, that are having a great conversation, and you said, excuse me, can I interrupt you and tell you why I'm great for the next 10 minutes and pass out my business card? Not going to go over so well. But we forget these constructs when we hop in the digital world, and we try to sell whatever we're trying to get out of it right away. And it's proven time and again that it doesn't work when it comes to social media. Now, the beautiful thing is, the difference is, on the flip side, is that now your advocates can do the same thing. They're going to listen. What's this organization all about? They're going to interact. They might donate their time. They might donate money. Then the third thing they're going to do is they're going to react. Based on their expectation, they just deliver on what my expectation was. And then last but not least, they're going to sell for or against the organization based on their reaction, based on that experience. So that's the difference, that last piece, is that there's tools they can use to really do that word of mouth on digital steroids, either positive or negative. So now we're going to look at what I like, the fun part of the program, as Amy and Seth alluded to, is that we're going to show some examples of where some people kind of stubbed their toes out there, and hopefully we can learn from their mistakes so that we don't make the same mistake. I'm going to stop this real sick. Just to preface this video, is that what happened is this gentleman, how many people have seen this United Breaks Guitars video? Okay, great, just a couple. So this guy took a flight in the United States. He's a musician. He's not James Taylor, but he took a flight in, and his guitar got damaged along the way. And so all he wanted from United Airlines was them to pay for that damage to that guitar. And so it spent them a year on the phone on the bad side of customer service, and eventually they said, would you please just go away? We're not paying for your guitar. And so then he realized, well, this is a new day and age. I can sell against this company. I'm going to write a song and post it on YouTube. And so this is Dave Carroll's story.
I flew United Airlines on my way to Nebraska. The plane departed Halifax, connecting in Chicago's O'Hare. While on the ground, a passenger said from the seat behind me, my God, they're throwing guitars out there. The band and I exchanged a look, best described as terror, at the action on the tarmac, and knowing whose projectiles these would be. So before I left Chicago, I alerted three employees who showed complete indifference towards me. United, you broke my Taylor guitar. United, some big help you are. You broke it, you should fix it. You're liable, just admit it. I should have flown with someone else or gone by car. 'Cause United breaks guitars. When we landed in Nebraska, I confirmed what I suspected. My Taylor had been the victim of a vicious act of malice at O'Hare. And so began a year-long saga of pass the buck, don't ask me, and I'm sorry, sir, your claim can go nowhere.
All right, we'll stop it there, but if you want to watch the whole thing, it goes on for two more minutes. You can watch it on YouTube. There's been 14 million views on YouTube for this, and United, the day this launched, paid for his guitar. So they didn't save any money after a year, and it cost them a lot of pain. But the story doesn't end there. What I want to really talk about is obviously that's some things where you can make a misstep. It's going to be blown up by your constituents out there, rightfully so, either positively or negatively. But also, what guitar does he mention in the song? Taylor guitar. So there's opportunity all around us if we're listening for it properly and we're able to move quickly. So Bob Taylor at Taylor Guitars gets on YouTube the next day and says, we're going to give you two brand new guitars. And for all the other folks out there that use their guitars that travel, these are some key tips so this does not happen to you. This is how you can avoid the damage that happened to Dave Carroll. Now the other thing is there's another company that produces guitar cases, and so they reached out to Dave Carroll, now they have a Dave Carroll guitar case. And the third opportunity was Dave himself. He sold millions of this song on iTunes for 99 cents, and he also has a book called United Breaks Guitars that came out a couple months ago. So there's opportunity all around us if we're able to listen and also react properly. So if we look at like a Kony 2012 that comes out of nowhere, is there a way to draft off that quickly if you see that there's a lot of searches? Because that term doesn't exist until all of a sudden it comes up Kony 2012 out of nowhere. So you can show up number two, number three on Google if you quickly decide it makes sense for you to leverage that. So that's how you can kind of move quickly in the space to tackle these opportunities. All right, this next one, I apologize. I'm going to showcase to you. There is swearing in this. I've left the swearing in there because that's how it is on YouTube. But this is a newscaster that you'll recognize from many years ago. He has a lot more hair. But we'll showcase this to you. The reason I'm showcasing this to you is because what happens offline also stays online. So what happens in Vegas now stays on YouTube. And the preface, what happens here is that a couple years ago, it's very popular to Rick Roll somebody. And what Rick Rolling was is that you'd get an email that said, hey, check out the latest figures from the last couple months. And you'd click on it, think it's going to take you to an Excel spreadsheet. But instead of an Excel spreadsheet, it takes you to this cheesy 1980s video by Rick Astley. And we'll all recognize the song once I play it. But that was being Rick Rolled. So they decide to Rick Roll Bill O'Reilly. And you can tell he doesn't react too well to that happening.
That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today. Okay, I don't know what, whatever it is, it's not right on the teleprompter. I don't know what that is. I've never seen that. Okay, but yeah, I can't read it. There's no words on it. There's no words there to play us out. What does that mean? To play us out.
It's Sting is going to do, it's a video, Sting video.
What is...
For credits.
I don't know what that means, to play us out. What does that mean? To end the show?
Yeah, yeah.
All right, go, go.
In 5, 4, 3.
That's tomorrow, and that is...
There's no strangers to us.
In 5, 4, 3.
That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today, and we will leave you with a... I can't do it. We'll do it live. We'll do it live! Do it live! I'll write it, and we'll do it live! Fucking thing sucks! That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today. I'm Bill O'Reilly. Thanks again for watching. We'll leave you with Sting and a cut off his new album. Take it away.
All right, so that obviously happened offline, and then one of his producers decided to post that onto YouTube. And yet, we see all these examples that constantly occur out there in the market, but we continue to make these missteps. I was just speaking this week in a very high-powered place with some high-powered individuals, and one of them on stage asked, are there any media in the room? Because he wanted to disclose something that was private. There's media everywhere. Everyone's their own media outlet. So that's a stupid question, actually, when you think about it. And it's great they're in the museum because everyone's their own media outlet. So you gotta live as if your mother's watching you. We didn't ask for that change, it's just upon us, and we have to deal with it. And so what does that mean? It means that all of us will have a digital legacy. And a digital legacy is really comprised of two different things. It's comprised of your digital footprint. That's something that you control. You control your digital footprint in terms of, I upload this on Facebook, or I post this to my blog. But the more important thing is the digital shadow. So that's part of Bill O'Reilly's digital shadow. Someone else posted that about them. Now the important thing to remember is all of us have a digital shadow. 92% of kids in the United States under 2 years of old already have a digital shadow. The parents have posted something about them online. So at the end of the day, it's really what do you want your digital legacy to be for yourself personally, but also for your organization. And so it's something to keep in mind when we're out there doing what we do. Now, historically, you had to be super famous to be made into a postage stamp. But now in today's world, everyone's their own digital stamp. And so we got to remember what is going to be our ultimate digital legacy, not 50 years from today, but starting now. If you look at Stephen Covey's The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, he talks about a length that we all want to know what's going to be read at our funeral. Well, we already know what that's going to look like because you can go and Google yourself and see what's being said about you today, about your organization. What is that legacy that's out there? And you can influence others with your legacy today, but obviously this stuff is not in pencil, it's in ink. It's going to be there for 50 years, 100 years, 200 years from now. What do you want people to Google about you, even though Google won't exist 200 years from now? What do you want people to find about you, your organization, 200 years from today? So if we look out there, I'm going to take a two-minute break here in a second, but when I'm traveling around, when I was doing Socialnomics for the last 4 years, is there's really three questions that people always ask me, whether they're a senator, whether they're a CEO, whether they're a soccer mom, whether they're a school teacher. Number one, how do I lead my best life in this crazy digital world? Number two, how do I get others to follow me both offline and also online? And number three, at the end of the day, what's going to be my ultimate mark on this world? And so the best thing that we can do as an organization and as an individual is really to write out our 140 character compass. Now, 140 character compass has double meaning because it's characters in terms of, you know, characters as you type into a computer, but also it reverts back to your character as an individual and also as an organization. So the reason you want to write this out is this is what you want your goal to be, to what people find about you, your organization, online. This is what you want your digital legacy to be. And you can always revert back to this if you're faced with a tough question or a tough challenge. So we're going to take 2 minutes, which is not enough time, but just take 2 minutes to kind of think about what you want your 140 character compass to be. If you're comfortable with it, I encourage you to email that, to post it on Twitter, to send it to someone of importance to you so they can hold you accountable for it. If you're not comfortable with that right now, just kind of write it out, think about it. Feel free to talk amongst yourselves, but we'll just do this for 2 minutes and we'll circle back. All right, that wasn't enough time, but it's to get you starting down that thought process. It usually takes about 7 to 10 days because it's that important to figure out how to make that small. Like Mark Twain said, is that I didn't have time to write you a short letter, so I wrote you a long one. It's really difficult to figure out what's that 140 characters going to be, but hopefully it's a step in the right direction for you, and you can always refer back to that if you're faced with a tough question at work or a question just in your personal life. Now, what does that look like on the organizational side? On the organizational side, because of social media, essentially your advocates are taking control of your brand. Whether we like it or not, that is just the world that we live in. And so the three questions you need to ask internally are, what's the reason for being? Also, two is, how do we differ from other organizations out there? How do we differ from our quote-unquote competition? And then three, what's the loss to society if we go away tomorrow? Now, these three questions are important, they're basic, but a lot of times I'm hired to come in to whether it's an organization or whether it's a company for a day and a half to interview employees or volunteers and ask them these three questions. And 9 times out of 10, it's all over the map. No one's on the same page. And that becomes a big issue historically, but it's even a bigger issue digitally because you've turned over your brand to your advocates externally. So if you don't have it on the same page internally, how do you expect other people to promote it properly externally? So this is an important exercise. It's an easy exercise to do. Just ask about 50 people, volunteers in your organization, these questions and see where they are. Are they consistent? If not, then you can quickly correct it. Another quick little tip, we don't have time to go over all the tips, but I'm not wearing a rubber band today, but normally I wear rubber bands for every day that I can go without complaining. So obviously I complained yesterday. So the average person complains 15 to 30 times per day. So if you can stop complaining, that'll put you above the rest. Now, it's really unrealistic to try to not complain every day, but what you try to do is a goal of get to 7 rubber bands on your wrist without complaining. Very hard to do. I've never made it. I've been doing it for about a year and a half. So now this is important offline, but it's also very important digitally. People post digital complaints, they stay forever. And so we've got to remember the stuff out there that complain equals digital pain. So if there's a way to kind of figure out ways that work for you to stop complaining or have your people that work within your organization to stop complaining, that's an easy key to success. So now let's look at what this looks like if you do complain out in a digital world. So this is from Chrysler's Twitter account. What they did is they had outsourced their Twitter account to an agency. So this young man in the agency was having a tough time with Detroit traffic, and he wanted to post something to his personal Twitter account. But unfortunately, he hit the wrong button, and he posted this to the Chrysler account. And so if you can't read in the back, it says, I find it ironic that Detroit is known as the Motor City, yet no one here knows how to blink and drive. So that goes out on behalf of Chrysler. Young man's fired that day. Agency's fired the next day. Now the key here, again, is that it's not a question on if we're going to make a mistake. It's a question on when and kind of how we handle it. So now we're going to look at the Red Cross. And the exact same thing happens to the Red Cross, is that this young lady hits the wrong button and posts on behalf of the Red Cross instead of her personal account. And she posts, Ryan found 2 more 4-bottle packs of Dogfish Heads Midas Touch beer. When we drink, we do it right. Hashtag getting slizzard. So that's on behalf of the Red Cross. Now again, a lot of times we can turn a negative into a positive. Now the Red Cross went kicking and screaming in 2006 and got everyone in the organization enabled on social media. They had to do it as a result of Hurricane Katrina. They didn't want to do it at first, but then it paid dividends when something like this happened. And so what happens is 4 minutes later, someone from the Red Cross saw that and then they post, we've deleted the rogue tweet, but rest assured the Red Cross is sober and we've confiscated the keys. So now what happens is that the Dogfish Head Beer Company gets involved and says, you know what, this week, and so they use all their media channels and said, instead of drinking a pint of beer this week, why don't you donate a pint of blood or donate some money to the Red Cross? And the Red Cross used this humor to say, look, we're just humans trying to help humans. There's humans at the Red Cross. It's not some big organization that's faceless. And so their donations actually went dramatically up the week this happened. So they turned that negative into a positive. And what that really looks like and what the term is for that is a term I love is really about being flawsome. So it's turning your flaws to showcase how awesome that you are. And so that's how you have to think about that. Whenever you make a mistake, it's an opportunity for you to capitalize on it. Seems counterintuitive, but it is true. If you look at Federal Express, if someone has an issue with them and they resolve that issue, that person's 3 times more likely to repeat as a customer than someone that never had an issue. So it's back to this question, hopefully they're not out there trying to make issues for all these people and fixing them. But it's just something to look about. That's what being flawsome is all about. All right, so now let's look at some other examples of people doing social media well. So if we look at Gary Vaynerchuk, he sells wine out of New Jersey. And so he decides, well, why don't I do a video series about, here's, I'm gonna teach people how to learn about wine. So I'm going to show you the first video that Gary does.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first episode of Wine Library TV. I am Gary Vaynerchuk, Director of Operations here at Wine Library at winelibrary.com, and I am very proud to launch what we think is the first video wine blog. We've been talking about doing a blog here at Wine Library for a long time.
Okay, that's Gary. It's kind of super boring. It's got a cashmere sweater on. He's got three neatly aligned glasses. He's talking in a civil tone. So what happens? Nobody watches Gary. So instead of throwing in the towel, he understands that you're not going to get it right the first time when it comes to digital media. It's about failing fast, failing forward, failing better. And so he used the constructs, I'm going to listen, I'm going to interact with my base, and I'm going to react based on what they say. And what do they tell Gary? They say, Gary, I can get this anywhere. I can get this in a boring book. I can get this online from other people that are a lot more advanced enophiles and wine experts than you are. What I want is someone to do it in a fun way. I want to do it, you to do it in the Jersey way. I want the real Gary Vaynerchuk to teach me in a fun way about wine. So now let's look at episode 505 and see if we can notice any differences.
Welcome to Wine Library TV. I am your host, Gary Vaynerchuk. Say it with me, Vayniacs. And this, my friends, is the Thunder Show, a.k.a. the Internet's most passionate wine program. I'm a 20% Mouvedra, 20 U.S. dollars. Pretty nose, like an Inclair, like, you know, let's give it a whirl. Nice fruit, dark chocolate, so let's go with like a 70% cocoa count coming through on this. Some lavender on the back end, which I like.
All right, so that's Gary. He's not for everybody, but he is for your base. It is for his base. And so he listened, interacted, reacted. He changed what he did. And what happens is, and the reason I use the example as well is because he's selling wine, which has got a lot of rules and regulations, 50 different rules and regulations. You're shipping something liquid. You have to be over 21 to drink this. So it's a very complex product to sell digitally, which you guys deal with a lot of complexity in what you're trying to do. So it shouldn't deter you from doing it, because this is one of the most complex things you can do digitally is to sell wine. And so what he does is he changes this up. All of a sudden he goes from selling $4 million worth of wine in 2006 to 2008, he sells $50 million worth of wine. Now the ROI on this, if you were to track this in a traditional manner, would have showed zero ROI, zero return on investment. Because you looked at this videos, it got a lot of views, but there's no sales that are coming from the videos. The sales are coming from Gary looking out there and listening on Twitter, on Facebook, on Pinterest, on YouTube, for people that are commenting about the videos. And then him and his team going in and saying, glad you like the videos. If you drink wine this week or drink one of my wines, let me know. It's a soft sell. That's how he increases his sales in 2 years from $4 million to $50 million. But if you looked at this from the top level, you'd stop doing the videos because it wouldn't show any sales. So that's what we're talking about, how engagement and relationships is the most important thing when it comes to social media. I can show you direct ROI, and I've got a video online that shows 30 different examples. But if you only look at that, you're missing 90% of the bigger picture. You'll never go from $4 million to $50 million with that type of engagement if you do that. Okay, now let's look at Wheat Thins. How many people buy crackers online? Again, they could have easily said, folded their arms and said, well, this isn't for us. Oh, sure, Nike can do this, or Apple, or whoever out there, they can do it, because they're this brand. But instead, they said, well, let's go see if anyone's talking about crackers or Wheat Thins online. And guess what? There's a lot of people that talk about Wheat Thins online. So they're just as surprised as you and I, and all of you and me. So all of a sudden, they go, what are we going to do about it? One young lady posts on Twitter, oh, man, my life is over. I'm out of Wheat Thins. I wish I had her life. Sounds pretty easy. But let's see what Wheat Thins decides to do about it.
This one's hilarious. Ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over. Kind of dramatic.
Tabitha.
Yes.
Okay, do you recall tweeting, ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over?
Yeah.
We got a hold of that. We just want you to be sure that you're aware that we have plenty of Wheat Thins. And that's for you. That's just a gift.
That is a lot of Wheat Thins. Oh my gosh.
Everybody in the van, let's go. In the truck. Take care, all right? Come on, boys. Who's next?
All right, so they do a good job with that. They're listening, interacting, reacting, taking advantage of the opportunity. So just think about how you can do what they did at your organization. So I'm not going to go through all this. I'm going to send out this sheet. A lot of these tools are free. These are tools that can track your digital footprint and digital shadow. And they're very simple. Most of them just have a box where you type in the name of your organization or your name, and it'll come back with a lot of useful data. I am going to go over just two quick ones on here that are very helpful. If you go to Grader, G-R-A-D-E-R, like grades.com, there's a lot of tools that can rank your website. So you can put in just your website address, and it'll come back and give you a grade of 0 to 100. It might tell you, hey, you have a grade of 70 because you haven't put your images don't have names to them, so Google doesn't know what those images are. And so you can really impress your IT group by walking down and saying, hey, we need to put more metadata on the first page because it doesn't show up. It won't show up in Google if we do that. So if you put in the grade for that, it'll come back and it'll give you a grade and tell you how to fix it, more importantly. And you could also put in your LinkedIn group. You can put in your Facebook page. You can put in your Twitter account. They have grades for everything. And so very helpful tools, and it's a free tool, to tell you, hey, this is where you could really improve your stuff in about 15 to 20 minutes. The other tool I want to point out is really an app. And so just a smartphone app. It's called Card Munch. How many people have Card Munch? Okay, great. You guys will love this tool. So what happens at an event like this? All these amazing people. You're like, here's my card, great, let's do coffee. Coffee never happens. So what Card Munch does is that, because you're never going to type in, probably don't have the time to type in the person's contact information into your phone. Card Munch, it's a free tool. You just take a picture of the card, it'll automatically upload to your contact list on your phone. Now, more importantly, it's also going to look at LinkedIn. If the person's on LinkedIn, it'll grab the person's picture and put the picture in. It'll pull in all the information from LinkedIn. So now you're going a week later, oh, yeah, there's the picture. I remember that person. Oh, it has all this detailed information, where they went to school. So it'll jog your memory a little bit better. It also allows you to hit a button if you want to connect on LinkedIn. So this tool is powered by LinkedIn. It was a company that was purchased by LinkedIn. And so it's a very, very helpful tool. You can start using it here today. It's called Card Munch. All right, so next things that are coming up, what's next? Kind of what's next? We don't have time. We can just talk about what's next for the next 5 hours, or actually 5 days. But obviously mobile is huge. The one thing I want to stress about mobile when you do your mobile initiatives is a lot of people go, let's do a game on mobile. Let's do a game. And everyone will love this game. Well, guess what? We're not experts on doing games, so it's probably not a good strategy to go down the path. What is a good strategy is figure out what can only you provide to that end user. So if you're an airline, it's, I can provide you an easy way to get your boarding pass, or just provide an easy way to let you know if your flight's on time. If you're Starbucks, I work closely with Starbucks, a lot of the issue they have at Starbucks is long lines at Starbucks. So how do we mitigate that pain of those long lines? Well, if you order the same thing from Monday to Friday, it doesn't make sense that you'd have to wait in line. And so what does make sense is if you have your phone and you enable this technology, that when you make that turn 10 minutes away from your Starbucks, it automatically places your order. So all of a sudden you walk in, your coffee's ready. That's great for the individual. It's also great for Starbucks because now they can track their inventory a little better so they make sure they don't run out of certain things. So that's what you got to keep in mind is when you go to mobile, what can only you provide out there today? All right, what else is new? What's new and the biggest change, the most radical change, is going to happen on the education front. There was a running joke that went on that said, hey, if you took a time machine from 1785 and you came to present day, the only thing you'd recognize is education. You'd have a teacher at the front of the room teaching. Nothing had changed. Now things are changing fast. If we look at something like khanacademy.org, if you have kids that are in middle school to high school, if they don't know about this, they need to know about it immediately, is that they're flipping the classroom, meaning that teachers are coming in and saying, your homework today is to go on khanacademy.org and watch this video on algebra. Then when you come in, we're going to do the homework in class. So I, as a teacher, can walk around and help you on an individual basis. So it's changing the way that homework works. A lot different than when we went to school in terms of you go home and do the homework, you'd have the lecture during the day. It's flipped. It's the opposite. Also with these e-readers, if you remember going into your college campus, you'd go to buy your used book and you'd have your fingers crossed going, man, I hope the person that had this book before me was smart and there's good highlights in here and good notes. The difference today is now you can see all those highlights on the Kindle. And so you could say, I want all the highlights from all the students that got a 4.0 or an A+ at Arizona State University. Or I want them from all across the country. That's also huge for the author because they can see what's being highlighted the most. And when they revise their book, they can pull those things out a little bit more. So education's changing rapidly. Think about iPads when it comes to kindergartners. We don't have time to talk about all this in length, but that's the biggest shift we're going to see in the next couple of years is education. Also, we're looking at, you guys obviously are nonprofits, but also if you look at companies, they're going to be, it's not what you do, it's why you do it. So this is starting to have a huge influence within corporations. So if you look at Oreo when they took a stand with their cookies, where they're making different cookies, they knew they were going to get a lot of flack when they did this pride cookie, but they stood by it. They stood by that they said, this is what we stand for as a company, and they moved forward. This is why we do it, not what we do. So it's important to look at that. Now this next video I'm going to show is older. It's a little grainy, and you can't see some of the text because we don't have the copyrights for it, but it's just to showcase that more and more companies are getting involved with really social advocacy out there. So it's a way for you to align with the right partners out there to really drive home what you're trying to do. And so this is for a self-esteem awareness. It's a video, it's a commercial done by Dove, the soap company. And so I'll just play this real quick.
World makes you crazy and you've taken all you can bear. You call me up because you know I'll be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show.
You're beautiful like a rainbow.
So that's Dove promoting self-esteem among young females on a regular budget. So again, you can align yourself with companies. So at the end of the day, it's really, we can all change the world more than ever before. That's why I'm excited to be in front of people here that are trying to change the game for the greater good, is that it's easier than ever, although it doesn't seem like that at sometimes with all the crazy digital tools that are out there coming at us nonstop. Is that success is really a choice in today's digital world. The choice is up to us on how much we can simplify our lives and simplify the lives of others out there today to take advantage of those opportunities, to make sure we listen, interact, react, and then sell. Or to fail fast, fail forward, and to fail better. And this last video I'm going to show to you is just to show you this, the rate of change is so fast out there today. We're just going to showcase a couple things in this video that really go into, it's going to be unbelievable when you look at it, in the last 20 years, some items that have gone away, that we were part of our lives that are still not there. I'm going to quickly jet through here. Back.
Video killed the radio star. Video killed the
All right, so as we conclude things this morning, we just need to ask ourselves the question of what's going to be our ultimate digital legacy as an individual, but also as an organization. And how do we do that? We fail fast, we fail forward, we fail better. We refer back to our 140-character compass, and we also just look out there and say, I'm going to listen, interact, and then I'm going to react. Because the question mark that we leave ourselves with is, what's that ultimate stamp on life that we lead? And the beautiful thing about presenting to you guys is you guys all understand that. That's why you're in this room. And that's why we see some of the greatest successes out there coming from nonprofits, whether it's from the YMCA, whether it's the Red Cross, whether it's Helping Hands, whether it's Men's Health. It's amazing to see everything that's happened within the last year and the last 5 years spiral out into the future. But I want to thank everyone for their time this morning. And again, please reach out to me at any time, and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. I want to thank Eli Lilly for having me in this morning. Hey, thank you.
All right, who has some questions for Eric? Come on. There we go. All right.
Hi, Eric. I'm Mia Loudon from Research America. It really freaks me out to give up my privacy. So if I see something and it's a website I don't intend to use very much, I don't want to put my name or my email address. Or if I see Facebook pop up on the side of some other page I'm on telling my friend's opinion, then I don't really want that kind of invasion. Yep. But do I have some obligation to do it just in the name of moving forward and so that my opinion will be out there for my Facebook friends?
There's no obligation, so I get that question a lot, whether it's from someone you or from a CEO. It's just do what's most comfortable for you out there. And so a lot of us are some are introverted, some are extroverted just before the web even started. I'm not saying you're an introvert or an extrovert. Is it on the privacy side? It's all up to you on your comfort level. But the one thing we do have to remember is there really is no privacy anymore. So do what you can to your best of your ability to lock down your privacy if that's what you want to do. But also understand, and there's a great quote from Scott Mahoney of Ford that took Andy Warhol's quote of everyone will have their 15 minutes of fame. He said now everyone will have their 15 minutes of privacy. So it's something to be aware of. It's not something we ask for. It's just something we need to adjust to and adapt to. But by all means, if you're not comfortable with it, use as many privacy tools as possible. But understand that it's probably not completely locked down.
Hi, I'm Darcy Gretadaro. I'm here from NAMI, and I have a question about noise. I love the example of the wine salesperson who did the sort of soft sell engagement, but I'm wondering at what point are people getting too much noise and starting to feel a little bit frustrated, and how do we balance that?
Yep. No, it's a great question. There's already too much noise out there, and it's increasing at an infinite level. So a question I get that's similar is how often should I post on my Facebook page, or how often should I tweet? Well, it should be based on, do you have something relevant of value? It's not a number. So you can, like the YMCA doesn't post that often, but they get a lot of likes and a lot of fans. Well, conversely, someone else might post a lot, and they're successful as well. It's all about, are you providing something of value to that end receiver? Just like an email, it only becomes spam once it's not of value. If it's of value, it's not spam. So a good rule of thumb is to do the 3-second rule. If you have to think more than 3 seconds whether you should post it or not as an organization, don't post it. It should be, man, everyone needs to know this. Everyone's going to be excited to get this news, and then we post it.
I'm Jan Brush with Prevent Cancer Foundation. In the privacy issue, you also have the issue of a management team who perhaps have their own Facebook, their Twitter, their Pinterest, all of those accounts, linking their own personal accounts to their nonprofit accounts, taking on controversial issues that perhaps the nonprofit wants to stay away from, but the individual wants to speak on. What are your thoughts on kind of mixing that? It's a very fine line.
It's a fine line. I'll always preface it with, you know yourselves the best, better than I do. But as a general thought, some people ask me, should I have 2 accounts? So I'm a CEO or at the top of this organization, should I have 2 accounts? I say 90% of the time that's not a good idea because, one, you've doubled your work. 2, you've doubled your opportunity to make a mistake. Again, going back to Chrysler and Red Cross, when they hit the wrong button, that's inevitable if you have those 2 accounts. And so 90% of the time it's not a good idea. Occasionally, it's a good idea if that what functions the best for you. Taking an offline example, when you mentioned that sometimes you have an individual, let's say it's a Mark Cuban or a Richard Branson, that might be very vocal, but they're also associated with the brand. A lot of times you can make that a positive if you want. If you look at like Obama and Joe Biden here, we're in DC, is that sometimes they'll put Biden out there and have him say something a little more controversial. Again, he's tied to that Obama brand, that Obama ticket, but they'll use that as another vein. So it's not necessarily a new thing. So it's just look at it and see, can we turn this into a positive? And this person might be able to say something a little more controversial. But if you have to get them in line, you should train everybody, just like the Red Cross does, on social media, just kind of on the basics so they understand, oh, wait, that could be a bad thing if I posted that, because a lot of people don't know.
Right. Yep. All right, we have one more question back here.
Hi, Eric. It was a great presentation. I'm Lida Vanegas from Mary Center, and I'm still struggling to be on social media and learning. And when I think of social media, because I'm still struggling, I think of Facebook and Twitter. But I was wondering why you didn't mention it that much during the whole presentation. We're just talking about that right now, but not during the whole presentation.
About Facebook and Twitter?
Yeah,
so if you look at social media, it's YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, LinkedIn, blogs. So it covers a huge gamut. Most of the media focuses on Facebook and Twitter. A good thing, too, is a lot of people try to boil the proverbial ocean, or another cliche is you got to take the elephant one bite at a time. So a lot of people make the mistake of trying to get on all the tools right away. It's really to figure out which tool's going to move or which two tools are going to move the best for you. So for me, it's actually YouTube, LinkedIn, and Twitter, where I know Facebook would be a huge help. It's just these work better for me. This one, if I have time, Facebook, I get to it. But these other three drive a lot more success. So it all depends on your organization, on what's going to function the best for you. Don't underestimate the power of LinkedIn. It's not talked enough about, because the media loves Twitter and Facebook because it's a little sexier. But if you look at the stock price of LinkedIn, there's a reason that it trades for 110, 120, and Facebook trades for 19. It's because they're a monopoly that no one really talks about on the LinkedIn side.